Cold Storage, a novel, by David Koepp. Performed by Rupert Friend. Prologue. The world's largest single living organism is Amelaria solidips, better known as the honey fungus. It's about 8,000 years old and covers 3.7 square miles of the Blue Mountains in Oregon. Over 8 millennia, it has spread through a web-like network of lines underground, sprouting fruiting bodies above the earth that look like mushrooms. The honey fungus is relatively benign, unless you're an herbaceous tree, bush, or plant. If you are, it's genocidal. The fungus kills by gradual takeover of the root system and moves up the plant, eventually choking off all water and nutrients. Amelaria solidips spreads across the landscape at a rate of 1 to 3 feet per year and can take 30 to 50 years to kill an average-sized tree. If it could move significantly faster, 90% of all botanic growth on Earth would die, the atmosphere would turn to poison gas, and human and animal life would end. But it is a slow-moving fungus. Other fungi are faster. Much faster. December 1987. 1. After they'd burned their clothes, shaved their heads, and scrubbed themselves until they bled, Roberto Diaz and Trini Romano were allowed back into the country. Even then, they hadn't felt entirely clean, only that they had done everything they could, and the rest was up to fate. They were in a government-issue sedan now, rattling down I-73 just a few miles from the storage facility at the Atchison Mines. They followed close behind the open-air cargo truck in front of them, tight enough that no civilian vehicle could get in between them. Trini was in the front passenger seat of the sedan, her feet up on the dashboard, a posture that always infuriated Roberto, who was behind the wheel. "Because it leaves footprints," he told her for the 100th time. "It's dust," Trini replied, also for the 100th time. "I wipe it right off, look." She made a half-assed attempt to wipe her footprints off the dashboard. "Yeah, but you don't, Trini. You don't wipe it off. You kind of smear it around with your hand, and then I wipe it off when we return it to the pool. Or I forget and I leave it, and somebody else has to do it. I don't like making work for other people." Trini looked at him with her heavy-lidded eyes, the ones that didn't believe half of what they saw. Those eyes and what they could see were the reason she was a lieutenant colonel at 40, but her inability to refrain from commenting on what she saw was the reason she'd go no further. Trini had no filter and no interest in acquiring one. She stared at him for a thoughtful moment, took a long drag off the Newport between her fingers, and blew a cloud of smoke out the side of her mouth. "I accept, Roberto." He looked at her. "Huh? Your apology for back there, that's why you're bitching at me. You bitch at me because you don't know how to say you're sorry, so I'll save you the trouble. I accept your apology." Trini was right, because Trini was always right. Roberto said nothing for a long moment, just stared out at the road ahead. Finally, when he could, he muttered, "Thank you." Trini shrugged, "See, not so bad. I behave badly. Almost, but not quite. Seems like pretty small potatoes now." They talked endlessly about what had happened in the 4 days since it had all started, but they were pretty much talked out now, having relived and re-examined every moment from every conceivable angle. Except for this one moment. This one had gone unspoken, but now they were speaking about it, and Roberto didn't want to leave it that way. "I didn't mean with her, I meant the way I talked to you." "I know." Trini put a hand on Roberto's shoulder. "Lighten up." Roberto nodded and stared straight ahead. Lightening up did not come easily to Roberto Diaz. He was in his mid-30s, but his personal and professional accomplishments had raced ahead of his chronological age because he never lightened up. He got shit done. He ticked boxes. Head of class at the Air Force Academy? Tick. Major in the USAF by the age of 30? Tick. Superb physical and mental conditioning with no obvious flaws or weaknesses. Tick. Perfect wife. Tick. Perfect baby boy. Tick. None of this could be accomplished through patience or passivity. Where am I headed? Where am I headed? Where am I headed? Roberto would ask himself. The future was all he thought about, planned for, obsessed over. His life moved fast, it stayed on schedule, and he played things straight. Well, most things. They both just stared at the truck ahead of them for a while. Through the canvas flap over the rear gate, they could see the top of the metal crate they'd flown halfway across the planet. The truck hit a pothole, the crate slid back a foot or so, and they both sucked in their breath involuntarily. But it stayed, settled in the back. Just a few more miles to the caves, and this would be over. The crate would be safely stashed 300 feet underground till the end of time. The Atchison Caves were a limestone mine back in 1886, a massive quarry that went down 150 feet under the Missouri River bluffs. They started out producing riprap for the nearby railroads and dug as far down as God and physics would allow, until the pillars of unmined rock that held the place up reached the very outside limit of any sane engineer's willingness to sign off on their safety. During World War II, the empty caverns, now a sweet 80 acres of naturally climate-controlled underground space, were used to house perishables by the War Food Administration, and eventually the mining company sold the whole space to the government for $20,000. A couple million dollars in renovations later, it had become a highly secured government storage facility used for disaster and continuity of government planning, storing impeccably machined tools in a state of well-oiled readiness, set to ship them anywhere, anytime. Only please God let there be a nuclear war first, so this was worth all the money. Yeah, it would be worth it today. The call had been a weird one from the first ding. Technically, Trini and Roberto were with DNA, the Defense Nuclear Agency. Later, it would become part of DTRA, but that particular government mishmash wouldn't be cobbled together until the Defense Department's official reorganization in 1997. 10 years earlier, they were still DNA, and their brief was simple and clear. Stop everybody else from getting what we have. If you smell a nuclear program, find it and wreck it. If you get a lead on some nightmarish bioweapon, make it go away forever. Expense will not be spared. Questions will not be asked. Two-person teams were preferred to keep things compartmentalized, but there was always backup if you needed it. Trini and Roberto rarely needed it. They'd been to 16 different hotspots in 7 years and had 16 liquid kills to their names. Kills were not literal. It was agency speak for a weapons program that had been neutralized. But there had been casualties along the way. Questions were not asked. 16 missions, but none remotely like this one. The USAF transport had already been warming up at the base when they bounded up the stairs and came on board. There was only one other passenger, and Trini took the seat directly opposite her. Roberto sat across the aisle in a backward seat, also facing the bright-eyed young woman in well-worn safari gear. Trini held a hand out to her, and the young woman took it. Lieutenant Colonel Trini Romano. Dr. Hero Martins. Trini just looked at her, nodding and popping in a piece of Nicorette, taking Hero's measure, unafraid to hold silent eye contact while she sized her up. It was disconcerting. Roberto just gave Hero a half salute. He never enjoyed playing the whole I see right through you game. Major Roberto Diaz. Nice to meet you, Major, Hero said. What kind of doctor are you? Roberto asked. Microbiologist, University of Chicago. I specialize in epidemiological surveillance. Trini was still looking at her. That's your real name, Hero? Hero hid her sigh. It was a question with which she was not unfamiliar after 34 years. Yes, that's my real name. Hero like Superman or hero like in Greek mythology? Roberto asked. She turned her gaze to Roberto. That was a question she didn't hear nearly as much. The latter. My mother was a classics professor. You know the story? Roberto looked up, squinting his left eye and staring into the space just above and to the right of his head, the way he did when he was trying to pull an obscure fact out of his brain's nether regions. He found the nugget of information and dragged it up out of the swamp. She lived in a tower on a river? Hero nodded. The Hellespont. Somebody was in love with her. Leander. Every night he'd swim the river to the tower and make love to her. Hero would light a lamp in the tower so he could see his way to the shore. But he drowned anyway, right? Trini turned and stared at Roberto, her displeasure plain. Roberto was good-looking to an irritating degree. The son of a Mexican father and a California blonde mother, he radiated good health and had a head of hair that would last forever. He also had a smart and funny wife named Annie, whom Trini actually found tolerable, which was saying something. Yet he'd been on this plane all of 30 seconds and was clearly trying to charm this woman. Trini had never picked her partner for a jerk before and hoped he wouldn't turn out to be one now. She watched him, chewing her gum like she was mad at it. But Hero was engaged. She kept on talking to Roberto, ignoring Trini. Aphrodite became jealous of their love. One night she blew out Hero's light and Leander was lost. When she saw he had drowned, Hero threw herself out of the tower to her death. Roberto took a moment and thought about that. What exactly is the moral there? Try to meet somebody on your side of the river? Hero smiled and shrugged. Don't piss off the gods, I guess. Trini, weary of their banter, glanced back at the pilots and spun a finger in the air. The engines immediately whined and the plane started to move down the runway with a jerk. Subject changed. Hero looked around, concerned. Wait, we're going? Where's the rest of your team? You're looking at us, Trini said. Are you sure? This might not be something we can handle on our own. Roberto conveyed Trini's confidence, but without the edge. Why don't you tell us what it is, he said to Hero, and we'll let you know if we think we can handle it. They told you nothing? She asked. They told us we're going to Australia, Trini said, and that you'd know the rest. Hero turned and looked out the window, watching as the plane left the earth. No turning back now. She shook her head. I will never understand the army. Me neither, Roberto said. We're in the Air Force, seconded to the Defense Nuclear Agency. This isn't nuclear. Trini frowned. They sent you, so I assume they suspect a bioweapon. No. Then what is it? Hero thought about that for a second. Good question. She opened the file on the table in front of her and started talking. 6 hours later, she stopped. What Roberto knew about Western Australia could fit into a very small book. More of a flyer, really. One page. And with large type. Hero told them they were going to a remote township called Kirakura Community, in the middle of the Gibson Desert, about 1,200 kilometers east of Port Hedland. It had been established a decade earlier as a Pintupi outstation, part of the Australian government's ongoing attempts to allow and encourage Aboriginal groups to move back to their traditional ancestral lands. They'd been mistreated and cleared out of those same territories for decades, most recently in the 1960s as a result of the Blue Streak missile tests. You can't very well be living on land that we want to blow up. It's unhealthy. But by the mid-70s, the tests were over, political sensitivities were on the rise, and so the last of the Pintupi had been trucked back to Kirakura, which wasn't even the middle of nowhere, but more like a few hundred miles outside the very outer rim of nowhere. But there they lived, all 26 Pintupi, as peaceful and happy as human beings can be in a stifling desert without power, telephone lines, or any connection to modern society. They rather liked being cut off, in fact, and the elders, in particular, were pleased with their return to their ancestral lands. And then the sky fell. Not all of it, Hero explained, just a chunk. What was it? Roberto asked. He'd been holding eye contact with her throughout the brief history so far, and don't think for a second Trini didn't notice. In fact, she was glaring at Roberto, as if psychically willing him to stop. Skylab. Now Trini turned her head and looked at Hero. This was in 79? Yes. I thought that fell into the Indian Ocean. Hero nodded. Most of it did. The few pieces that hit land fell just outside a town called Esperance, also in Western Australia. Close to Kirakura? Roberto asked. Nothing is close to Kirakura. Esperance is about 2,000 kilometers away and has 10,000 residents. It's a metropolis by comparison. What happened to the pieces that fell in Esperance? Hiro turned to the next section.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.